Well, so a few weeks ago, we had a Numberphile video where I reported on the discovery of 42 as a sum of three cubes.
There it is, I can see it.
Oh, yeah, yep. So in that video, I said that we're going to have a go at finding a representation for three. We're going to throw everything we have at it, and we'll see. But, you know, this kind of thing, you never know. It's a once-in-a-generation kind of thing. Okay, and before anyone expected it, it just popped out.
You've got it.
We've got it, yep.
Three was already known as a sum of three cubes, wasn't it? In a couple of ways.
That's right. Should I write that down?
Yeah. All right.
Three had two known representations as a sum of three cubes. One cubed plus one cubed plus one cubed. And also four cubed plus four cubed plus negative five cubed. So both of them single digits. This was the problem that kicked it all off. So it was in 1953 that Mordell asked, kind of as an offhand remark, actually, in the middle of a paper about something else, he says, I don't know anything about the solutions of this problem, you know, other than the two easy ones, and it must be very hard indeed to say anything about other possible solutions. That turned out to be an understatement, because it took 66 years to find the next one, and it has a couple numbers with 21 digits. Two of them have 21 digits, and the other one has 18.
We should point out there are some numbers that can never be found.
That's right. So if your number, if you divide it by 9 and you get a remainder of 4 or 5, then we know you can't do it. So 4, 5, 13, 14, etc.
But the others?
It's expected. There's a conjecture that says that there ought to be infinitely many representations as a sum of 3 cubes.
But it's not proven.
No, it's not proven. Well, so there are a few numbers for which it is, and I think Tim talked about this in the very first video. You can write down parametric families for the number 1 or 2, okay? But starting from 3, and many numbers have no such parametric families that we know of, and we don't expect them. Nevertheless, we think that there are infinitely many solutions. They're just kind of sporadic.
So the conjecture is every number other than that special class, mm-hmm. has infinite number of ways to express it as a sum of three cubes.
That's right. And there's even kind of a conjectured density. So we expect, you know, there's a formula for how many we expect roughly up to a certain number of digits. What's special about three is that it has the lowest expected density of any number up to 100. So it's not so surprising that this one was hard. Nevertheless, we did have to go much further than we would have expected to find the third solution.
And just quickly, how did you find this new one for 3? Same way you found 42?
Yeah, pretty similar. It turns out there's some optimizations that are specific to the number 3 that we could do. And more or less, that let us go another order of magnitude for free, you know, over what we could do for 42. And so it was about the same size computation. As for 42.
And you use this big network, this Charity Engine network.
Yeah, we use Charity Engine. And to be honest, we have yet to throw anything at the Charity Engine guys that caused them to break a sweat. I sent an email with a new version of the code around noon on a Monday. And 7 hours later, I got the email with the solution. Partly that was down to luck, but also partly because, you know, Charity Engine's network is big. I was in band rehearsal. And, you know, just during break time, I checked on my phone and saw it there and was really excited. I'm pretty sure my bandmates think I'm a complete nutter now.
Did you tell your bandmates?
Well, not all of them, just the ones near me. I tried to explain a bit, yeah.
Are any of them mathematicians, or were they like...
No.
So they were just like, okay.
Yeah, whatever, Andy, yeah.
Why is this significant? It seems like, I mean, you're just knocking off one number at a time and one new solution at a time. This, like, you know, this could go forever. Why was 3 worth even doing?
That's right. Well, I mean, partly it's for historical reasons, because this is the problem that kicked off the whole thing. And it's very satisfying to be able to solve this. There are theoretical reasons, too. So this touches on something called Hilbert's 10th problem. So Hilbert made a famous list of 23 problems at the beginning of the 20th century, you know, kind of outlining his vision for mathematics in the coming century. Number 10 on the list was to find a way of telling if any given Diophantine equation has a solution or not. So that's just a polynomial equation, and you're looking for integer solutions. At first glance, this seems pretty reasonable. So in school, you learn how to solve linear equations and quadratic equations. At university, you take it up to any number of variables. But it turns out, so this is one of Hilbert's problems that's solved now, but probably not in the way that Hilbert envisioned it all. So it's solved in the sense that we know it's impossible. Okay, so for general Diophantine equations, it's not always possible to solve them. So there can be Diophantine equations out there that have no integer solutions, but also no way of proving that fact. And what makes this example of the sum of three cubes really interesting is it's, you know, right at the sweet spot for being a difficult problem along these lines. On the one hand, it's very close to things that that are relatively easy, that we understand. For instance, if instead of three cubes you had three squares, right, then we have a complete characterization of those numbers that can be written as a sum of three squares. In fact, that's a famous theorem from the end of the 18th century of Legendre. Or if instead of three cubes I had two cubes, and then again we have a characterization of those numbers. And likewise, I think if you have more cubes, then it's not completely solved for four cubes, but there's lots of progress. It's three cubes where it's really turns out to be difficult, and really nobody has any idea how to attack this theoretically.
Andrew, I can see why 42 was fun to do, because it's 42 and it was the last one below 100.
Yeah.
And I can see why 3 was worth doing, because it has this historical niceness to it. It's where it all started. But for how long can you just keep picking off these solutions? I mean, when does all the attention turn to a concrete proof?
That's right. So, the problem is, for given all that we know now, this might be the only thing that we could do. So as far as anyone knows, there could be a Diophantine equation of this type. You know, for instance, 114. That's the next number we don't know. Does it have a representation as a sum of three cubes? It's conceivable that the answer is no, but also that there's no way to prove that. So it's a little dissatisfying, but, you know, that could be the case. And we don't think that's the case. We think that if you look long enough, that you will find a solution. But nobody knows for sure. And even that in itself could be an undecidable problem. Does every number that we think should have a representation have such a representation? I always get very confused when I go down this rabbit hole. It goes very deep. But
where do you stop? I mean, are you searching for 114 now with Charlie?
We are going to. So, every time I think we're finished with this, then we think of a few more things that that we can do. So we are going to have a go. Actually, I haven't said yet. We found a representation for 906. So that knocked another number off the list. We're down to 9, up to 1,000. But I should say, yeah, I'm quite skeptical that we're going to solve all of the 9 remaining ones up to 1,000 anytime soon.
But is there a point just continually knocking these off the list if you think they've all got one anyway? Shouldn't all the energy be going into the proof? Are you working on the proof, or is that not your area?
That's not my area. I am somewhat sympathetic to this. Yeah, so the point is to go until you're pretty sure of what is true. I think we're at that point. For a while, that wasn't always the case, right? There was maybe 30 years where many people thought that maybe this wasn't true, you know, that there weren't any more representations for 3, or there weren't any for some of the other small numbers, 33, 42, etc. Now we're pretty sure that Heath Brown's conjecture that says there are infinitely many is true. We have good evidence for that now. And so at least we're trying to prove the right thing.
You probably saw in the last video, lots of people say, this is cool, but what's the point to keep doing this? Why are you keeping doing it? You say you're pretty confident it's true. This computational power could be used for other things. Yeah. Why keep knocking the numbers off the list? Just for completeness?
Or? Yeah, so we are going to stop eventually. Mostly it's just a bit of fun. Yeah, and the historical reasons for 3 and the numbers up to 100. That's right.
And you want to finish that 1,000 list, maybe?
honestly, Brady, I'm not sure that I'll live long enough to see the 1,000 done.
Really?
Yeah. Well, I've had discussions about this with my daughter, too. Yeah. It's a bit fatalistic, but yeah. She might live to see it, but I probably won't. Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah. Last time we spoke about 3, and within days you'd found it. Why do the remaining 9 ones below 1,000 have to be so unobtainable? Couldn't they just be a similar number of digits? Or do you think one of them has to have...
It's possible. But so I talked about this conjecture density, right? And for some of these numbers, I'd have to look up, I think it was 390 that has the lowest density. It's really small. And if you haven't found one by a certain point, it's kind of like, you know, if you expect your bus every 10 minutes, if it's supposed to come every 10 minutes and you've been standing there 20 minutes at the bus stop, you still expect to wait another 10 minutes, right? It's that kind of thing. So it's very likely that we'll have to go another 7, 8, you know, maybe more digits further than we have up to now to find a representation for 390.
Where's the next 3 likely to be? The next one for 3? How many?
That also I'm not expecting to see anytime soon, yeah. So we expect the solutions for 3, on average, to get about 7 digits longer with each new solution.
I notice always the three numbers always have a similar number of digits.
Mm-hmm.
Is that...
So this one was a little peculiar. So it was quite extreme. It was very skewed. So the first two numbers were nearly equal in size, but opposite in sign, so that they almost cancel each other out. And then the third variable was small, right, just to make up the difference. That happens a fair amount of time, actually. So one feature of the new algorithm that we're using, as opposed to earlier attempts, is that it only matters what the size of the smallest number is. Right, so if we had to do a search that went all the way out to finding the biggest numbers, then we wouldn't have been able to do it with the technology we have now.
Is it possible there's a solution for three with smaller numbers that you've brushed past?
It's possible. It depends on what you mean by smaller. So there shouldn't be any with the smallest number, smaller than the one we found. But because the first two numbers are so enormous in the solution that we found, it is conceivable that there's a solution where the total digit size over all the numbers is smaller, yeah.
How are you feeling about it? This is...
I feel pretty good, yeah. It's quite satisfying, and I think we're nearing a sense of closure on this problem, but let me turn it around and ask how you feel, Brady.
Well, I know the Numberphile video, like, nudged you to look into this, so I feel like some sort of 0.001% involved.
You're being modest. So I would say that Numberphile's contribution has been as important as mine or anyone else's who's worked on this. So in fact, each video gave us just the boost that we needed to tackle the next challenge. Starting with the first one, you know, with Tim Browning.
I mean, maybe this number doesn't belong on the list. Why is the number on the list if we haven't got a solution?
That's a very good question. There have been some attempts to prove that this number isn't on the list, but those attempts have failed.
So that got Sander Huisman's attention, who ran a bigger search and found 74.
This guy, Sander Huisman, has gone away and calculated a new solution to one integer that was previously unknown, whether it was a sum of three cubes or not.
And then it was that video on 74 that really got me into it, and we found 33.
We found three integers whose cubes sum to 33. There's always another number. For us, the next one is 42.
And then, you know, the publicity around that, and with the video on 33, that attracted the attention of Charity Engine and Andrew Sutherland also, and we've just pushed further and further. So it's, you know, it's been kind of a domino effect. A highly improbable sequence of events.
What about that elusive, like, rigorous proof, though?
Yeah, that takes mathematicians who work in Diophantine equations, algebraic geometry, to focus harder on this. That's not something you can predict. So it takes a new idea beyond, you know, an idea that no one has ever had to solve equations like this theoretically.
Do you have any correspondence with those sort of people? Like, will you tell them about this new number and hope to encourage them?
Tim Browning is the closest, yeah.
We'll get in touch with him.
Yeah.
Get him on the case. All right.
Yeah, so maybe we'll look for the next, for the Parker Square now, or something like that.
You can get yourself a 42 t-shirt or hoodie from our merch store. See the links in the usual spots. And also thanks to our Patreon supporters, 42 of whom... some of them randomly selected, are being sent one of these 42 mementos signed by Andrew himself. This is one seriously nerdy collector's item. You can support us at patreon.com/numberphile. We're always trying to do new little extra things to show our appreciation.